Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat live lectures. Dear friends, today in immunology we will be talking about transplantation and rejection. To discuss this topic we have with us our subject expert Dr. Anita Kamra Verma. Dr. Verma is associate professor in department of zoology in Kirorimal College, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome ma'am.
Good evening everybody. Thank you Amrit for the welcome. And in continuation with the series of the immunological lectures, today I shall be doing transplantation and rejection. Now transplantation and rejection are some things which never happen in nature. And nobody tries to impose a new set of tissue or cells in nature. So it is definitely something which is because of the advancement of medical sciences that this study has become extremely important. So although I'm going to talk in two series of transplantation and rejection, they are somewhat overlapping. So the first thing is when I introduce transplantation, what do I mean by transplantation? And transplantation can never be without immunology because it is the immune cells of the body which decide whether they have to accept or reject. So any events that are going to be present within the body whenever there is an invasion of a foreign microbe or a foreign tissue, what occurs is a system of recognition and rejection or acceptance. If the person is susceptible, they die. If the system is not susceptible, they will fight. And to fight, they must have sufficient immune response to reject. Now, when we talk of this, I had earlier mentioned about certain grafts, when I spoke of allograft, xenograft, and also a few other syngenic grafts, where I mentioned about the donor being the same as acceptor, or donor belonging to one species and acceptor belonging to another species. But there is a donor and there is a recipient. So when there are two persons involved and we are manipulating one's tissue to another, this is called as a transplant. Then there is a major limitation. We cannot have success in this case if we are not careful. We have to see the body's immune response before we come to any conclusion. So what do I mean by the immunology of an allogenic transplantation? That means there is recognition of transplanted cells. They may be self, they may be foreign, but this recognition is done by polymorphic genes. And these polymorphic genes belong to a class of cells which are called as the major histocompatibility complex. And this MHC molecules are inherited by both parents, that is, they are co-dominantly expressed. Alloantigens can elicit both humoral response as well as cell-mediated immune response. What are the type of grafts? I have mentioned earlier as well. There are self-grafts, which are called as autologous, that is used in bone marrow transplants, in peripheral stem cell transplants, in skin transplant, maybe even for a bone. There are syngenic. What do I mean by syngenic? When there is syngenic, that means they are identical twins. And in case of identical twins, there is a rare chance of the graft being rejected. Then there is something called as allogenic. When I say allogenic, that means another human, but not an identical twin. That means I can give the transplant from one human to another. When I say xenogenic, when it is xenogenic, then it means a transplant has to occur from one species to another. Interestingly, I can classify the grafts based on the same definitions which I have given or the terminology which I have provided earlier. That is the allograft, autologous grafts, that means from one part of the body to another of the same individual, syngenic, which is also called as isografts, allogenic, which was called as allografts, and xenogenic, which were called as xenografts. This was a slide which I had earlier shown to you people or the students who have been following the immunology lectures, that autograft, allograft, isograft, and xenograft. So this cartoon makes it very simple for you people to recollect your earlier lectures. What are the different types of tissue transplants then? I have given you the classification of grafts. I have made you understand what is a transplant. And now I want to move on further, connecting the two. What do I exactly mean when I say there is a tissue transplant? Everybody in their households must have had some relative or the other getting a kidney transplanted or a liver transplant done, and none of the students may have sat and thought about it, that why is it that one has to look for a kidney donor so that the kidney is not rejected and accepted by the patients. So when I talk of the tissue transplants, I talk of the sources. What are the sources? It could be a live source. That means I take from a living patient and give it to a living person to a patient. Or I can take it from a cadaver. Cadaver are the unclaimed dead bodies which are made available for medical research. Or I can take from pig or some other animal which has genes which are similar to ours so that there is no immune response. What do I mean by an autologous graft? When I say autologous graft, that means I can take the skin from my hand and put it on the skin of my leg. Or during burns, you see that the body has burned, so that part of the body is replaced. The skin of that part of the body is replaced from skin where it is functional. I can have an artery transplant from one part of the body to another part of the body. Or I can have peripheral blood stem cells can also be grafted. So this would also come under the category of a tissue transplant. When I say isograft, that means any organ, and any organ, and there is no rejection in such cases. When I say allograft, what do I mean by allograft here? A kidney transplant, a heart transplant, even a liver transplant. This all comes under the category of an allograft, where I'm taking it from one human and putting it in another human. It can be rejected. It can be rejected unless and until we have found a typical HLA tissue type. That means there has to be there does not have to be a mismatch. The match is not only of the blood groups, but it is also of the human leukocyte antigens, which are, again, when I had taken the class on MHC molecules, I had made the students realize the importance of HLA typing. There is a xenograft. Xenografts are definitely not a very successful and a very comfortable option, although they do exist because people are trying to take the heart of a pig and trying to put it in the heart of a human. Here, unless and until the patient is made non-immunogenic, there are complete chances of rejection. Also, the valves, only the valves of the pig heart are being replaced at this moment. So, interestingly, everything comes back to the basic of immunology, where the entire new system which is introduced into an organism depends on recognition and acceptance or rejection. So, what is the recognition? The only thing which I have followed till now is that there should be recognition of alloantigens. When I say alloantigens, again, you must understand that antigens that are specific to that particular species. So there will be a direct presentation and there will be an indirect presentation. When I say direct presentation, what do I mean? I mean that there is a recognition of the intact MHC molecule, which is displayed by the donor antigen presenting cell. That means the donor antigen presenting cell has to be in the graft. So now the graft is playing the role of presenting the MHC molecule. That means the self-MHC molecule will not recognize the structure on the self, but it will recognize the entire structure of the allogeneic MHC molecule present on the graft. That means, again, the involvement of CD8-4, that is the helper cells, and CD8 toxic cells will always be there. So if I look at the cartoon, allogenic antigen presenting cell, which is present in the graft, is going to make the T cell alloreactive. When I say alloreactive, that means it is specifically getting activated based on the alloantigen. So this is an unprocessed antigen. whenever I have taught you, I have made it very clear that the MHC is responsible for putting an endogenous or exogenous part of the antigen as an on the surface of the antigen presenting cell. That is what is recognized. So here what is being recognized is the entire MHC molecule from the allograft. That means, again, unprocessed antigen. Next, when I move on to an indirect presentation, what do I mean? That means that there is a donor MHC, it will process it and then present it by the antigen presenting cells. So the antigen presenting cell will be of the donor or of the recipient. It will always be of the recipient because the graft will not carry the antigen presenting cells. The graft only puts its antigen across as the whole antigen or as a processed antigen. So that means a donor MHC molecule will be handled in the same way as a foreign antigen which has entered the body. So this should involve only the CD helper cells. This does not involve the toxic T cells, so that the antigen presenting cells will only represent of the class 2 MHC molecules. Interestingly, now look here, when you say allogenic MHC molecule, I have the professional antigen presenting cell, it will introduce it, it will take the entire allogenic MHC into the cell, process it and then present it like the professional APC cell and then activate the T cells. So that means there are two ways when the recognition can occur of the skin or the graft what we have introduced into the organism. So that means I'm looking at tissue as well as an organ transplant. When I say, is it possible now? Yes. Trying to understand all this has made it also reasonably understandable that all these tissues can be transplanted. And the most common transplant which we have been following over the years is of blood transfusion, bone marrow transplant. We've been hearing of these, of the heart, kidneys, pancreas, lungs, livers, even intestines. And the tissues, there is a difference between a whole organ transplant and a tissue transplant. This include bone, cornea, skin, heart valves, veins, arteries, cartilage and many other connective tissues. So what are the sources of stem cells for transplants? There is a bone marrow graft, peripheral blood stem cells and the umbilical cord. What are the type of transplants? Again, when I want to understand, there will be an autologous transplant or an allogenic. No other transplant. The rest are all to be understood theoretically, but clinically, medically, there are only two types of transplants which take place. One is the patient's own stem cells and allogenic is stem cells from someone else of the same species. That will be the donor cells. All this is just a line which I have picked up from a paper from 2006, bone marrow transplant, which said that hematopoietic stem cells for over 22,000 people have been done successfully. What are the laboratory tests we can do? We do an ABO blood group typing. We do a tissue typing, that is an HLA typing. We do a lymphocytotoxicity test. We do a mixed lymphocyte reaction. Or we can also screen for the presence of preformed antibodies to allogenic human leukocyte antigens. Or we do a cross-matching. When I do a serological typing, what do? That means I take the anti-sera. Please remember, in the serum, there are antibodies to the molecules which are present on the surface of the RBCs. But when I take the antibody of this and raise antibody against this, that becomes the antibodies to sera. So that is called as anti-sera. So anti-sera has to be of a specified specificity. It has to be anti-AB, anti-A or anti-B, then only can we use it for clinical testing purposes. We can use the complement and the trypan blue staining system to see whether the cells are viable or dead, because trypan blue is a vital dye which can only be internalized by the dead cells because there is loss of membrane integrity. Now, this picking up of trypan blue will tell us that the cells are dead or lysed because they are not matching. If there is no aggregation, that means this is not called as aggregation, I'm sorry, this is called as agglutination. So when there is agglutination, automatically trypan blue is going to be internalized. Now this is how we attack it. We have the HLA-B8, you have the anti-sera to this, and we have the complement. So what happens when the trypan blue is internalized? These are the ones which will give us the idea of what is the group which is present. But what we understand medically and clinically, what are the testing which occurs? This is the most common transplantation, which is the blood transfusion, where we have the Landsteiner's ABO blood group typing, where we have an anti-B and anti-B, the surface of the RBC express these polysaccharides, and these polysaccharides are either expressing A, they will have antibody B. If they are expressing B, they will have an antibody A. And if they are not expressing anything, they will have none. And if they are expressing both, they will have an antibody A as well as B. So if I take a recipient who has anti-A and anti-B antibodies, so it cannot, this will require blood group. Where I'm saying the green lines, all these are transfusible. And the red ones are clearly not to be transfused. So that means if there are no antibodies, then everybody can give the blood. That is why it was called as a universal acceptor. And O blood group was considered to be the universal donor. But this does not exist true anymore because there is more complication arising because of tissue typing. So then the next thing to remember is tissue typing or the mixed lymphocyte reaction, because whenever I talk of the HLA, HLA is clearly the leukocyte antigen. That means it is present on the WBCs. Now, when I say the cells being tested have to be incubated with the cells to be typed, that is, again, I have to know the specificity of the cells. Once they recognize the foreign cells and proliferate, that means they will now carry the same specificity to that particular foreign type. And what do I see here? There will be recognition leading to transformation and proliferation. But if there is no recognition, there is no proliferation. So that means there is no reaction. So if there is no reaction, there is a chance of the graft to be accepted. If there is reaction, there is 100% chance of the graft to be rejected. Then we talk of bone marrow transplantation. When we talk of bone marrow transplantation, what are the things we talk about? We talk about leukemia, anemia, or some kind of immunodeficiency based on other cell types. So we try to replace the cells of the bone marrow. And I spoke of severe combined immunodeficiency disease, whereby all the cells of the body are compromised and the bone marrow cells are replaced so that the patient develops its own immune system. In this, we have to inject 10 raised to the power of 9 cells, that is, it is almost 1,000 million cells per kilogram of the host body weight intravenously into the recipient. But the recipient should have no cells of its own. So the recipient is first kept in a sterile environment, completely immune compromised, and then only these cells are injected into the system so that the body accepts these new cells as cells and gets the old cells are completely eliminated, which were the defective cells. This bone marrow transplant can also fall into the category of gene therapy, because during gene therapy also we do a complete blood transfusion in case of patients who have defective WBCs or defective bone marrow hemopoiesis. Now, the donor bone marrow has to contain immunocompetent cells. The donor cannot be a weak donor. So they pick up a donor which has very strong immunocompetent cells, competent. That means they are capable of building an immune response. And the graft has to be such that the body does not reject. So here I'm talking about graft versus host reaction as well. These are terms I'm introducing and I will be explaining as we move forward. When I was speaking of mixed lymphocyte reaction, what did I want to define? that there can be tests in vitro. In vitro is when I'm simulating an in vivo, simulating a condition which exists within the body, outside the body. And we are trying to make everything artificially, but maintaining all the systems of the body. There has to be T cell regulation and allogenic MHCs. I also have to have a donor irradiated mononuclear cells. We have to have responders. When I say stimulators, then I have to have immune competent cells. When I say responders, I need to have recipient mononuclear cells. That means donor also has to have the same cells, recipient also has to have the same cells, but in an immune compromised situation. When I measure the proliferative response of responders, I get to know how the proliferation is occurring. How do I do it? By do it by using tritiated thymidine. This is radioactively labeled. And each time the reaction for proliferation takes place, that means during cell cycle synthesis, thymidine is used, and whenever there is proliferation, this tritiated thymidine will be picked up instead of normal thymidine, and we will get to know by the radioactivity how many cells have been able to multiply or grow. That is proliferation. What are the requirements for this experiment? This is very simple. We can do an adoptive transfer. When I say adoptive transfer, that means I do not have to give the antibodies directly to the patient. I can grow the antibodies against something in another animal, and I can just pick up the cells which are required and infuse into another animal. That means they passively act. They have not been activated directly. So the cells are being transferred from one animal to another animal. This is called as adoptive transfer. Now this adoptive transfer also requires co-stimulation. That means you have to stimulate both the responder as well as the recipient. When I say requires MHC, yes, it requires MHC molecules. It requires class 1 as well as class 2 differences in MHC molecules. That means CD4 as well as CD8 T cell responses. You can see this. I take the mixed blood mononuclear cells from two donors. This is in vitro. This is when I say we are doing it in a tissue culture. Then I am growing them in an incubator which has a 37 degree temperature, 5% carbon dioxide, and they are artificially grown. What do I see? When I see the responder T cell recognition, then I see that the responder cells are exhibiting class 1 as well as class 2. So that means this forms the stimulator cell. If not, it will form the recipient where it is going to either lyse the target cell or it goes into an activity and it gets activated and cytokine secretion takes place. So it is very important to understand what happens in the entire mixed lymphocyte reaction, because mixed lymphocyte reaction is very clear that you're not picking up either T cells or B cells. It means that we are picking up all the cells together. The only consideration is the donor as well as the recipient. Again, for histocompatibility, if I want to do a laboratory testing, what do I do? I use a flow cytometry. I will be doing the immunological techniques at the end of the series so that you are able to understand all what we have spoken. When I talk of flow cytometry tests, we are trying to look at the test to look at the HLA or the human leukocyte antigens. Serological tissue typing, I have already spoken of. Mixed tissue typing, I have already explained. Now I move on to what is graft versus host disease. Please remember, it is not a disease, but it is mentioned so because at every point when we are dealing with it, either the host is superior or the graft is superior. So the entire balance of the graft versus host reaction will lead to something known as a graft versus host disease. This is caused by the reaction of the grafted mature T cells in the marrow inoculum with alloantigens of the host. That means if there is an acute graft versus host disease, this generally will lead to cell death. An epithelial cell death in the skin or the epithelium dying in the GI tract and or the liver not surviving at all. When I say there is a chronic graft versus host disease, then this is characterized by atrophy and fibrosis of one or more of these target organs as well as the lungs. Okay, Now I will take one by one the tissues. Heart transplantation, lung transplantation. Heart transplantation was first picked up in South Africa by Dr. Christian Bernard. Lung transplantation was done by Hardy and co-workers in 1963. Kidney transplantation, 90% of the tissue transplantation or the organ transplantation which takes place is kidney. Liver, we are seeing 70 to 80% survival rate. Pancreas transplantation is good for people suffering from diabetes mellitus. Skin grafting is generally done for patients who have had skin burns. When I talk of xenogenic transplantation, I must also mention whether a major xenogenic transplantation has ever occurred. No, it is only the heart walls which are being tested. When I talk of early allogenic transplantations, we also talk of early allogenic transplant rejections because there can be toxicity. The DVD patient, they have less leukemic relapses. So there is graft versus leukemic reaction and graft versus host reaction. Both are immune mediated. That means there is a donor cell, there is a recipient cell, and the natural killer cells which get activated, we have to see which response is better, whether the GVD or the GVL. So balance of this immune response, where we minimize the graft versus host reaction and maximize the GVL, is what is required. Or we also require the immunosuppressive theory or the bone marrow transplant theory. So whether the source of stem cells for transplant, which I had mentioned, that there are peripheral blood stem cells. So what is important, what should we remember in this? That there is a foreign MHC molecule which can directly activate T cells. This is unique for transplantation. Host versus graft response that can lead to rejection. But graft versus host reaction can reach us to accept the graft. Do I have a presentation of the graft antigen? Yes. There is a high density of MHC molecules which react very weakly. Graft molecules can present the graft's own peptides, including the peptides from both major and minor MHC molecules. Host antigen presenting cells can uptake different graft molecules and process these antigens. Thank you. Back in continuation, now after giving you the importance of the transplantation, that the body will have only two kind of conditions where we have the graft versus the host reaction or the host versus graft. If the host versus graft reaction is better, the transplant is rejected. If the host versus graft reaction is better, then there is a complete chance of the graft to be accepted. So When I present the graft antigen, like I mentioned, that there is a high density of the graft MHC molecules which will react very weakly to the T cell receptors. When it interacts so weakly with the T cell receptors, automatically the T cell activation is very slow. But graft MHC molecules, when they start presenting their own peptides, including the peptides from the major as well as the minor MHC molecules, then these processed antigens can actually cause the lack of host tolerance. This is important. I mentioned host tolerance earlier. Energy, that is wastage, that is also important to remember. The host antigen presenting cells can uptake different graft molecules, process them and present them differently. If you see this cartoon, you can see the graft and you can also see the self molecules which are getting processed within the graft system. And when these antigen presenting cells are going to give the graft MHC molecules or the graft peptide on the surface to be recognized, automatically the host is going to create good have a recognition, but this will depend on the concentration of the peptides being expressed by the host. So that means again the role of MHC molecules becomes primarily important. When T cells are exposed to the foreign cells, non-MHC molecules, then the clones are actually tricked into activation because they think it is self, but they are basically non-self, which are going to bind to the T cell receptors, and the foreign peptide is going to make a complex with the host. This itself leads to the recognition of a foreign as self. T cells which are reacting directly with the donor antigen presenting cells which are expressing the allogenic MHC molecules will show a co-stimulation, and this co-stimulatory activity itself can lead to the acceptance of the graft. But the minor H antigens which are present on the MHC molecules will be encoded by the genes outside the MHC. It is important to now see and understand whether the T cells will get activated and the cytokines will also play a role. Yes, there will be two roles played. One is activation of T helper cells and activation of cytotoxic cells, that means CD4 and CD8, as well as delayed type hypersensitivity. Now, this again depends on direct recognition, which I had spoken about a few minutes earlier, and on the indirect recognition. That means direct recognition of the unprocessed antigen as well as the processed antigen. Indirect donor antigen presenting cells are going to inactivate, or they will shed the MHC that activate the immune system. That means the transplanted organ will stand and get reacted by the host. That means, and this cartoon I have picked up from the Nature reviews of immunology. So it is almost the latest kind of research which is happening, where we are explaining to you how immunology becomes very important in graft versus host reaction. So that means studying of immunology of transplantation and rejection, why is it important? It becomes very important to understand, or it led to the discovery of MHC molecules. It also led to the discovery of understanding the T cell activation response to alloantigens and to non-antigens. That means it led to understanding the function of the T cells, and also this reactions helped us to understand how to make drugs which will going to cause immunomodulation and improve the applications. The applications I have already spoken on, that the kidney can be accepted as a transplant, heart, liver, cornea, pancreas, bone marrow, small bowels, that means intestines, or skin. So that means what is important in immunology, that there should be recognition between self and non-self. Very good for transplants. Is it graft versus host reaction which is disastrous, or is it blood transfusion which is disastrous? Either not. Both are not disastrous. Is skin transplantation genetically different organisms possible? Yes, but there are system of graft acceptance. If I look at this cartoon, what do I understand? That the autograft acceptance, there is a graft, the epidermis has been grafted, there are blood vessels. Within 3 to 7 days, there will be revascularization. In 7 to 10 days, there will be healing. Neutrophils will start appearing, which is the first line of defense. And by 15 days, the entire wound is accepted. So here, the autograft is accepted. That means the skin from one part of the body to the other part of the body is completely accepted. But what happens when there is a rejection? That means I've taken a graft from some other place and put 3 to 7 days the revascularization will occur as before, but there will be cellular infiltration which will lead to a lot of confusion, and there will be a number of cells which will start dying. This will lead to thrombosis, leakage of the blood vessel, finally killing of the cells, which causes necrosis, and this causes a lot of damaged blood cells. Here, this is the first set of rejection. That means the graft is being rejected. Second set of rejection, what happens? That the grafted epidermis is there, the revascularization does not occur as should. Within 2 to 3 days, you have a set of cellular infiltration. There will be a lot of mediators which are going to cause thrombosis and necrosis, and we will have a whole lot of necrotic tissue instead of the graft. So that means there is complete rejection occurring within 10 days. So this is called as the second set of rejection. That means what have I done here? The person who was given the first set is being given a second set of rejection. That means the body's immune response is heightened and the rejection occurs faster than before. So that means till now I have understood that there is a lot of benefit of transplantation in clinical medicine. I also know that there is an immunological response or mechanism to rejection. I also know that immunological and physiological barriers exist for transplantation. I also know the role of T cells and the MHC molecules in rejection. But now I need to understand the methods of rejection and how to prevent the rejection. I also know and understand how to use the laboratory tests to understand the tissue compatibility. Why is the organ rejected? The immune system is very complex, but it also has yielded to evolutionary stresses which have been provided by coexistence of the microorganisms for millions of years. So that means my system is divided into autoimmunity as well as adaptive immunity. That means there is a natural immunity, innate immunity, which is non-specific immune response, and there is a specific immune response based on B cell and T cell. Still, why is the organ rejected? The organ, which is the principal target of the immune response in a graft versus host reaction, basically has to be dependent on MHC. This again will come under the category of adaptive immunity, not under innate immunity. We are born with innate immunity, and adaptive immunity is more based on specific T cells and B cells. Now, when I say it all depends on MHC molecules, then it should be equal or similar in all the humans or a species. It doesn't happen. There is, again, it depends on the polymorphism, and this polymorphism can only be understood by the MHC molecules or the MHC gene. There are receptors on B cells which are called the Ig receptors, and they can recognize the antigen portions of the intact molecules. But mostly the intact molecules are recognized again by the MHC molecule. So what are the types of rejection I'm looking at? I'm looking at host versus graft. When I talk of in terms of rejection now, they become hyper acute rejections. That means hyperacute will be rapid, minutes to hours. It has to have a humoral response. Humoral means there has to be antibody-based response. These responses will be based on the antibodies which are already existing, or the complement system which has already seen these antibodies. This is generally the fast reaction occurs when there is a mismatch in blood groups, or there is a xenograft. That means if the tissue does not belong to the same species, then there is acute rejection. When I say acute rejection, this is either humoral or cell mediated. This can take days to weeks, which I have just introduced a few minutes earlier. Then there is a chronic rejection. This chronic rejection will allow the graft to be there for months and years, and this will continue to be there because of the immunosuppressants or the immune suppressive drugs which have been given, or it can live up to 7 to 8 years. Beyond that, if the drug is stopped, it might show a rejection. So this becomes a chronic rejection. And of course, graft versus host, which I have explained earlier, and I will again take it up later. So rejection, what do I understand? First set and a second set rejection. The first set rejection will take 7 to 10 days, but in the second set, if I give to the same patient, the same skin, within 2 to 3 days, the entire skin is rejected. So what is the mechanism? We must think about the mechanism now. There are foreign alloantigen recognition, which I have explained. There is memory lymphocytes. That means the body has seen the graft. There are antibodies in circulation. And this is part of the specific immune response, which is the adaptive immunity. Can I transfer this adoptively? Yes, I can allow the graft to be grown in another patient, allow the antibodies to be grown, and to the actual patient, you just take the antibodies which are already showing a recognition to the patient. Here, one step is taken over and the patient gets relief that the body does not have to fight or create antibodies. So if the patient is in such a state where they are very immune compromised, it is a good idea to give antibodies which have been processed earlier. So this is called as adoptive transfer. So again, I will show you a cartoon which clearly shows the mice showing first set and second set of allograft rejection. This we have already seen, but it is just, now I have picked this up from a book called QB, Immunology by QB et al. So you must have a look at this book. What is an alloantigen recognition? Again, based on MHC molecule, based on direct presentation, based on indirect presentation. Taking it further from what we had done earlier, I will take the class 1, class 2, which are the most polymorphic genes of the human genome, which have to be codominantly expressed. I am going to revise the map of MHC molecules again for your good benefit, that we have the class 2 region, which shows all the genes. And I will also show you the comparison map of the human and mouse, human leukocyte antigens, which show the similarity between the two, where we have the DQ and DR, which are important for MHC class 2 locus. In mouse, we express it as H2, and in human, we express it as HLA. But I had given this cartoon to you all earlier to understand. Here again, I'm bringing in the importance of polymorphism, because without the polymorphism and without the codominantly expressed molecules, we are unable to process or understand the graft versus host reaction. What do I mean by T cell recognition? When I say the T cell recognition of peptide, you must remember T cells never recognize the antigens. They can only recognize the antigen if they are complexed with the antibodies or on the antibody on the surface of the B cell. But T cells can recognize the MHC molecules which are expressed by the antigen presenting cells. This is again the cartoon from Abbas, the direct and indirect, which I have already explained to you. So when I say activation of alloreactive T cells, what do I mean? Antigen presenting cells, if we remember, they were the dendritic cells, the macrophages and the B cells. So alloantigens will have CD4 and CD8. When I say co-stimulation, that means I am going to form an immunological synapse by the antigen presenting cells, by the MHC, CD40, ICAM1, these are the intracellular adhesion molecules, and T cells, then again CD8, CD28, CD40, CD2, LFA. Does the antigen presenting cells secrete cytokines? Yes, they will release cytokines which are going to further stimulate the T cells, and they are mostly the interleukins. Can I measure them in vitro? Yes, I have explained how we can measure them in vitro. So now let me come back to the chapter where I had taught you immunological tolerance. And here I'm talking about immunological activation. Is there a correlation between T cell energy and T cell activation? Yes. When I look at the allergen reaction or the allergen recognition, I have to see the recognition based on the response. Am I wasting the activation? Because if there is stimulation all the time and there is no recognition, what happens? There is a tolerance being developed by the patient. So that means I have resting co-stimulator deficient antigen presenting cells. What is the T cell response? There is no response. But when there is activated antigen presenting cells, then the effector cells are there, which is going to cause the T cell proliferation and further activation. So T cell energy versus T cell activation is also very important for graft versus host molecules. Next, we move on to understanding the cellular and molecular understandings. That means there is association within the graft rejection as well as the immunosuppressive therapies. Rejection has not been eliminated, but it has only been reduced. That means when I talk of hyperacute reaction, or I talk of acute reaction, or of chronic reaction, what are we looking at? We are looking at the hyperacute rejection. We see that whether it is cell-mediated immunity or not. That means a hyperacute reaction depends or happens within few minutes or maximum a few hours. It results in the destruction of the transplant by preformed antibodies. Some of them which are produced by the recipient before the transplant. So that means where is the time for them to get activated? So in this hyperacute rejection, there is no play of cell-mediated immunity. This is totally dependent on the humoral immunity of the person because it is totally antibody dependent. Antibodies activate the complement system, then platelet activation, causing hemorrhage, causing swelling or inflammation. And these antibodies, the preformed antibodies, have been produced because of earlier transplants, or maybe blood transfusions, or maybe pregnancy. Further on, what is an acute rejection? When I say there is an acute rejection, here the patient has not been sensitized to a transplant earlier. It is mediated by T cells. So is it important that this is cell mediated? Yes, this is cell mediated immunity because there is direct recognition of alloantigens which are expressed by the donor. This is very common in mismatched tissue or insufficient immunosuppressive therapy. That means immunosuppressants which are given are low. So what is the pathological mechanism of rejection? That means there could be only, when I see pathological, I'm going to show you the histological slides also which express what I'm saying. Hyperacute for bone marrow, is it applicable? No. In bone marrow, there is nothing called as a rejection because you give the bone marrow transplant to a person who is completely immune compromised. When there is acute rejection, yes, in bone marrow transplants, a primary graft failure occurs many a times, but this will only occur after a month or maybe 15 days. And this generally occurs because of the natural killer cells of the host, or because of the lysis of the donor stem cells by the natural killer cells. But acute rejection in normal patients occurs because of the antibody immune response as well as the cell-mediated immune response. When there is a chronic rejection, does a system like chronic rejection exist in bone marrow transplants? Yes, it occurs because in bone marrow transplants, there will be a secondary graft failure which can occur within 6 months. That means from 30 days to 6 months, there is a possibility of a rejection of bone marrow transplant. And this also occurs because of autologous T cells. That means the host has T cells which get activated. So the T helper cells are responsible for activating the T cytotoxic T cells and lysing them. So that means there can be a rejection after 6 months, which falls under the category of a chronic rejection. Does a chronic rejection occur in case of a solid organ? Yes, because this occurs because of accelerated arteriosclerosis, and this is again because of CD4 as well as CD8 helper cells, because of macrophages, and a rejection will occur after 6 months to maybe even 8 to 10 years. When I look at the immune mechanism of a solid organ rejection, I have already explained. So you just see it by the cartoon and you will understand that there is endothelial cells, there is an alloantigen. Here you are seeing that there is a whole lot of complement system getting activated, and the endothelium, that is endothelium is the lining of the blood vessel inside, this is getting damaged. There is inflammation and thrombosis happening. When I say acute rejection, here I have the alloantigens on the cells which are getting activated. Again, the antibody or the alloreactive antibody will come and sit within the blood vessel, and wherever these antibodies are present, they are going to cause the lysis of the endothelium cells, which are going to get killed. So you basically have the interstitial inflammation which causes a lot of damage. When there is chronic rejection, what do we see? That the chronic rejection is not in the blood vessels inside. Chronic rejection will occur because of the mismanagement of the vascular smooth cells which are present. That means it affects the muscle cells rather than the endothelium cells. And the blood vessel wall starts becoming thicker and thicker, leading to the occlusion of the blood vessel. That means the blood vessel gets completely clogged. And that is the reason that there is a rejection, and this rejection takes so long. So that means allograft, even the examination of the rejection site will tell us that there are a lot of lymphocytes, and these lymphocytes can be actually seen nicely. If you look at the histology, you will understand what I am saying. The histopathology shows that the cell, the wall, inner wall of the blood vessel is getting damaged. And here you can very nicely see that the blood vessels on the outside are getting occluded because of the presence of chronic rejection. And here it is acute rejection where the antibodies have caused so many thrombosis of the endothelium of the blood vessels. Can I prolong the allograft survival if there is so much of immune response? Yes, I can prolong the allograft survival by giving anti-inflammatory agents or giving cytotoxic drugs or giving immune suppressive drugs or giving new immunosuppressive therapies or strategies which can help the prolongation of the survival. What are the kind of drugs? Normally methotrexate, cyclosporine, rifamycin, corticosteroids. All these are the drugs which can be used for allograft survival. Can I use an antigen-specific tolerance versus general immune suppression? Yes. If I use antigen-specific tolerance, that will decrease the risk of infections, maybe even secondary cancers. It can actually enhance the allospecific T regulatory stimulation. It can cause the monoclonal antibodies or the co-stimulatory bodies to molecules to be blocked. There could be decrease in graft immunogenicity, transplant to privileged sites, or if I inject a thymus with an alloantigen, I can actually lead to induce a clonal deletion. That means the donor antigens will be tolerated. So can I have a T regulatory cell function improvement? Yes. Can I induce tolerance and enhance the allospecificity of T regulatory T cells? Yes. Can I manipulate the T regulatory activity to induce transplant tolerance? Yes, I can do an ex vivo manipulation or I can do an in vivo manipulation. When I do an ex vivo manipulation, I have an alloantigen. I can use vitamin D3, or I can use dexamethasone. I can use cytokine therapy, that is tumor growth factor beta, IL-10 or FOXP3 transduction. And I can actually control the T regulatory cell. So if I activate the T cell, make it into a T regulatory cell, I can maintain the body's graft. When I say in vivo manipulation, I can further use a calicinurin molecule, which I can use as a delayed calicinurin inhibitor, or I can use another regimen by way of regulating that, which will again maintain the in vivo manipulation of the graft. So when I say prevention and treatment, yes, I should have an ABO compatible, MHC allele has to be closely manipulated, calcineurin inhibitors, ionosine monophosphate dehydrogenase inhibitors, these all inhibit the enzyme at the enzymatic level, which is going to cause the immune graft to not be rejected. Or I can have the M tolerance, we can have the antibodies to T cells, I could have corticosteroids, anti-inflammatories. So if I take a neonate and an adult and see the rejection, I can see it very nicely. T cell tolerance mechanisms. Finally, my summary, what do I mean by the transplantation? I had transplantations of four kinds, autologous, syngenic, autogenic, and xenografts. Then I had first and second set of graft rejections. We had MHC class 1 and class 2 presentations, direct and indirect MHC presentation, antigen presenting cell T cell activation, mixed lymphocyte reaction, pathological mechanisms whereby we showed hyperacute, acute and chronic inflammation and rejection, prevention of rejection, immunosuppressive reagents, mechanism of immune tolerance, and graft versus host disease. Thank you.
On that note, I would like to thank ma'am for this very enriching discussion, and thank you dear friends for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.